What was your relationship with Cowboy Bebop? How did you find it?
I think just like, you know, I've always been into anime culture, you know, and it's just like been some, it's been some iconic classic anime, yeah. You know, from, you know, growing up. And, but like when, yeah, when I heard about you getting involved, that was really cool.
Oh,
that was when I'm like, okay, this is dope. It's live action. It needed to happen. And then I got to remix the iconic track Tank, yeah. You know, it's like attached to the IP. So
it's really like, cool. It's the greatest opening for a show. I can't think of a better opening for a TV show.
Yeah,
it's
it's
a really great piece of music.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's also like crazy as I think about it, like when you're growing up, it's probably, I feel like when I was growing up, Asian pop culture wasn't cool.
Yeah.
And to be here in this moment, it's this larger moment. You know what I mean?
It's interesting you say that because I used to go to anime club mm-hmm. when I was in college.
Wow.
And in the 90s, right? And it was a total nerd fest. It was like me with a bunch of other geeks.
Yeah.
And it wasn't cool at all.
Yeah.
But we were like so obsessed with like anime.
Right.
You know, and now it's like, it's just everywhere. You open up Netflix, it's actually like probably one of the most watched categories.
Other thing I always thought that like what was interesting about Asian film was that in their culture, in China, Japan, Korea, at least I can say, they, you know, adults read
manga,
right? Yeah. And that to me has always struck me as storyboarding for films. It's like it's sort of in the culture,
right.
And so then they go, because it's not considered for kids only, it kind of elevates the art form.
Well, it's like it's in Japan, it's everywhere you go, you have a character that depicts something that you're supposed to do, like walk across streets, like a little cute little anime going, okay, you can walk now or you can stop now. It's just part of like normal life. Here it's in America, it's I always wanted to see more of that.
Yeah.
And it's, I mean, now it's happening.
Right.
Now you see it, like it's definitely a constant conversation. You hear about it all the time. It's like, you know, wherever you go. But
have you ever heard of webtoons, by the way?
I love webtoons. Yeah.
Yeah. I haven't seen them. I don't get them on my phone or anything.
Yeah.
I understand on my last trip to Korea that this is a popular form of entertainment. If you don't know, they send. So how does it work? They send panels.
Yeah. It's like it's called like vertical scroll. Like, that's the thing where you see it. Like you go up.
And it's daily, right?
Yeah, it's daily. And there's tons of content. I think the great thing about webtoons is that there's a lot of these new indie artists that are able to showcase their stories, their books, you know, their online books.
So there's a low barrier to entry. So it's not like you have to depend on gatekeepers to get in and do your thing. So that's really cool. It's democratic that way. Can you discuss the conception of the Cowboy Bebop Tank remix and how you got involved?
Yeah. I'm not sure who talked to who on the Netflix side versus our side, but this was a big deal for me when it came to my table that I could remix Tank, because I'm just already an anime kid at heart.
Yeah.
So, it's always tough when you have such pressure on something so iconic.
I wouldn't know what you're talking about.
you got the hair out to a T. So just the pressure of that, it's a lot right there. But but I was like, you know, I want to make it groovy.
Yeah,
you know, I mean the original is very jazzy.
Yeah,
and electronic music is not jazzy.
Yeah, yeah.
It's hard to take those time signatures and put it into something that's like very, you know, structured in electronic.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But I wanted to make it groovy, and I want to make people dance. And I was this is something that you could play at a show, at a club. But you could definitely play just watching or sitting in your home or whatever.
Yeah, yeah, you're right. I hadn't thought about it because the original it's kind of aggressive, right? It's propulsive.
Yeah.
And yours is like, has all these spaces, actually. It goes.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, it's cool. Have you met Yoko Kano, by the way?
No. Is she here?
She's in Japan, I think. Yeah. She's going to be here tonight?
Yeah.
Oh, really?
This is a big deal. You know, you're a big deal, John. You know that, right?
I didn't know that. Is that a secret?
You're a little big deal. Just slightly.
Oh, shit.
Everyone's coming for you. Everyone's coming for John Cho, you know? Like, come on.
Oh, wow.
No, I heard she's coming here tonight, so I was excited to meet her. But, you know, I mean, she's a legend. And I think it's really cool that she's a female in the space doing something like you, like, you know, in jazz and like in all this art form, you always hear of like, you know, the legends, like Miles Davis, John Coltrane, all like the legends in space, but like a female jazz composer is just incredible to hear about. And I, her, especially, because she's.
When I learned about the show, and then when I was offered the show, I said, I think one of my first questions is Yoko Kano in? Because I was like, I don't think it's wise to go forward without her.
Right. Yeah.
Because I felt like the way the treatment of the music completely changes the meaning of the scenes.
Yeah.
Because she has such power over what the show means.
Yeah.
Scene to scene. You know what I mean? Because she makes choices that that other music supervisors would never make.
Right. Simple, right. Exactly.
You know what I mean? Like, exactly. Because she's going against the grain a lot of the time.
Yeah.
Because you think the scene is about A, but her music makes you think, oh, it's about B.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, yeah.
Wow, man, I can't believe she's coming tonight.
Yeah. This is going to be cool.
Okay. That's cool. No big deal. What does Cowboy Bebop represent to you as a Japanese American?
I mean, I love that. I love when Japanese culture is being heralded. It's being showcased.
Yeah.
And we can go back to classics like this.
Yeah.
You know, and then revisit it and bring it back to this new life.
Yeah.
And anytime any sort of Japanese culture comes out, it's really exciting. You know, so
I also think it's like really cool. I don't know if you agree, but like for an Asian composer to take Western genres and go, let me take that.
Yes.
Do my thing.
And then it is different. Yeah. Like it's something.
It's its own thing.
You can't even. Like it's hard. It's like its own lane. It's like, of course, it's like it's jazz and it's rich and it's got so much dynamic elements. But you can't make that unless you're in a completely different environment and with a completely different headspace.
And you can't do it without mastery of it.
Right.
Yeah. So she just owns all these genres, and it's really fascinating. What are you most excited to see in the live action series aside from?
Dude, I'm rooting for you, John. So I'm here for you. I'm here for you. I mean, Spike is
that was the correct answer.
Yeah, the intelligent dog is sitting here. I'm like, I'm here for you. of course.
Thank you, my man.
You're the Spike is the favorite for me. So
thank you. Well, I hope I don't disappoint you. Yeah. We'll see you afterwards. We'll see you after this. Screening and you'll let me know. I'm going to go to some press questions here. Given the huge significance that the original music played to provide Cowboy Bebop so much crossover appeal internationally, what was your thought process in approaching this project? Interesting.
Well, I mean, electronic music, just by the pure base of it, it's like the fourth language. Mm-hmm. It's like the language that breaks the fourth wall. It goes globally, you know, like everyone can connect to it. So I think in that regard, as long as you just get that feeling and it emotionally tugs you as opposed to, if that's what it's doing to you, then it's doing its job. And I think everyone can relate to this. Doesn't matter where you're, what walk of life you're from, what language you speak. I hope everyone loves it.
I'll go down the list here. Yoko Kano's music in Cowboy Bebop has elevated the series to another level. What were the challenges? Well, I think we covered that.
Yeah.
Since jazz encourages improvisation, do you see a connection between that and the notion of a remix?
Yeah, I mean, remixing is you are essentially improvising.
Yeah.
You are improvising on the spot, and I'm taking like that all those the MIDI, the melody of the bass that you're hearing. I'm improvising on top of what samples I'm deciding to choose.
Yeah.
You know, because like. I took like the iconic hits that are heard in the actual track, and I wanted those to resonate. But then I wanted to be like, well, I got to Aoki by this thing. I got to make it dancey. I got to make it fun, and then meld that on with the vocal samples with Let's Jam. You got to put Let's Jam there. It is like, you know, you can do it live. It's a bit more difficult on the spot, but. There is an improvised element, of course, in the actual production of
that show. Is so much like the process of us making the show also, which is to keep like, I mean, I guess talking in musical terms, like you want you want people to recognize the melody.
Yeah.
You know, well, that's the song.
Yeah.
But also do your own thing and stretch it as much as you can and put your own spin into it. So
absolutely.
That's comforting that you had the same thing.
What
memories do series like Cowboy Bebop invoke for you?
It's just that little kid in me, like, you know, getting excited to see, you know, I remember like when I first saw Ghost in the Shell, the film, and, you know, just like all the Studio Ghibli stuff, all the toy animation stuff, I followed them. Like, it's like when you like one IP or one project or one storyline, you just want to follow the maker, you know?
Yeah.
It just never goes away though.
Yeah.
You know, it's like exactly what you're saying about in Asia, you know, it doesn't matter if you're 10, 20 or 40 or 50 or 60, people are still reading it as part of their culture.
Yeah.
And I see that happening more and more now.
Does it take you back to your youth too? Because like some of the technology in the show is like, it is of its time, you know, it's like a show set in the future, but like it was made at a particular moment. So there's like VCR, stuff like that.
I'm a collector too, so I have some of the Dragon Ball cells. So I like to like collect some of the things that like I remember seeing when I was younger, and like, oh shit, this is like the one scene right here, and it's painted in the back and stuff like that. So you know, nostalgia actually was a big deal during COVID. Going back in time.
Oh, interesting. And,
I had time to like on my hands, you know, like going back, these are the things I used to love when I was a kid, and now I'm older I have like time and money to actually go. And
how long did you take off from live shows because of COVID?
Definitely a year plus 5 months. Wow. Like that. What about you? I mean, you're still working, right?
We were shooting the show in New Zealand, which happened to not have COVID,
right?
Because they closed their borders.
I heard about that,
so that was really a relief for us,
right?
I
mean,
and just on a personal level, like not having to fear it.
Exactly.
That's nuts, not be just having that cut out of your life.
But you know what, it's I realized how adaptable I am as a human being, because I actually really really enjoyed it.
And
I toured for 15 years, like 200 to 300 shows a year.
Wow.
And it never stopped. It's not like, you know, some bands, they like do an album and then they tour off the album, and they take a break.
You're doing a Bob Dylan style.
Just keep going.
Get off the road.
Yeah.
Wow. That's nuts. There's a chance in remixing Tank, which originally incorporates Latin elements in its composition, how'd you balance adding in your signature EDM sound as well as paying respect to your Japanese American roots?
My sound is definitely global. Like I take a lot of Latin elements into my music already. People don't even realize how many Latin elements are actually in other tracks that are very non, like you wouldn't think of as a Latin. It's like everywhere I go, and luckily for me, I travel the world. So I'm constantly influenced and informed by all the sounds that I hear.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, it could be anywhere in it, like a taxi cab in South Africa. I could be hearing music that the taxi driver's playing, and I'm like taking my notes. I'm like, who's this? Where is this from? You know, like, And I try to book studio time wherever I am, whether I'm in like Europe or Morocco or Australia.
You mean you try to book studio time when you're traveling because you're like, I'm absorbing something. I want to see what comes out.
And also I want to book studio time to meet up with artists in those regions. That way, like when they come in, a lot of the times they bring in their arsenal. So I have my arsenal, like my hard drive of stuff. And I'm like, I want to hear your signature, your sound, your rhythms, you know, like being in the Middle East, like there's different rhythms, there are different time signatures. And I'm like, wow, this is so, so different from what I would think of. And like to get in the studio to mash minds with the best of that region, which is always exciting stuff.
Dude, you may be the most self-actualized person I've ever met.
Well, I mean, you say, look at you. I think about what you have to do. You change roles constantly, and then you're at peak performance of what you do, which is why John Cho.
Right.
You know, like you're John Cho for a reason, because every time you take on a role, you own the role, you become that, where everyone like goes, okay, that's, you know, like, okay, he's this person. Everyone thinks of you this person, and boom, you switch it up.
Right, right.
You know,
right.
I mean? Like you switch, constantly switch it up. And that's extraordinary. A lot of people get stuck in a certain role, right?
Yeah.
Especially Asians.
Yeah.
The
certain
thing too is like, an interesting conversation. It's like, you know, the people that in the power seat saying, well, you're this look to the world, so you have to represent what people expect of you.
Mm-hmm.
But you keep breaking the mold and doing different things.
Thanks, really cool. Well, I always thought that also people were like, oh, well, are you afraid of doing, you know, being stereotyped in comedy if you do Harold and Kumar or something? And I was like, bro, I'm Asian. I'm familiar with them. I'll take on that stereotype.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So you just learn to resist and move on, right?
Yeah, definitely.
There's a chance that this remix, this is cool, will be someone's first introduction to Tank and Cowboy Bebop. How's that make you
That's
feel?
That's actually very cool.
Yeah.
You don't think about it because, you know, we know about the original.
Yeah.
We know about the original song.
Yeah.
And how important it is to Cowboy Bebop as a brand. So, like, I never thought about it like that, you know? Because, you forget, like, that there's these young kids that weren't familiar, didn't grow up with that.
Yeah.
So, wow, that's
I'm actually thinking cool. that the show could also lead. I'm thinking the same thing.
Yeah, it's really like, cool. You are Spike for, and then you know, as
that's really cool because it's special. It's a special experience.
Yeah, absolutely.
We'll go on to the last question. As an Asian American who has had a successful career in entertainment, how do you feel the industry has changed from when you were first starting out to now?
Unfortunately for DJs, there's not that many known Asian DJs.
Mm-hmm.
They're coming out of the woodwork, but it's few and far between to find other prominent Asian DJs, even Asian worldwide musicians.
Really?
Yeah. I mean, you really think about you have the K-pop world that's just bursting at the seams with BTS. So everyone knows BTS. But you think about Asian American musicians and artists, there's not that many that are like well known.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like Mike Shinoda, I always looked up to mm-hmm. because Linkin Park is one of my favorite bands of all mm-hmm. time. And he was a front man and he was the writer and he was a musician. He did everything in the group. And I love Chad Hugo from the Neptunes.
Mm-hmm.
They were my favorite producer. They actually inspired me to become producers.
Oh, yeah.
A producer. And, you know, he's like a Filipino dude right next to one of the coolest guys on the planet, Pharrell, making music with him. But there's just like, it's just like, I love to see more Asian representation in music, period. And I always tell kids that come up to me that are aspiring musicians, I'm like, just keep making them hits, keep putting it out there. And there's enough platforms and to be heard.
Yeah. Well, but that surprises me just with the availability of technologies, what you can do at home on a computer nowadays and what you can do solo or with, with other people.
Yeah, exactly.
And collaboration is so much easier than it used to be because of the computer, right?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I do more collaborations not in person than I do in person.
Really?
Yeah. It's like a lot of just sending files back and forth.
So you work on it and then you send it back and back and forth and go, wow, man, that's.
Yeah. I mean, I could deliver an entire song, like the vocals, the melody, the actual record to someone else and they just sing it and they just send it right back, you know? So it's, I mean, as much as I love in person and I used to do writing camps at my studio, obviously with COVID that really limited that, but you just get used to like sending files back and forth and it doesn't seem so foreign anymore to do that.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
But from my perspective, like on the film and TV side, it's been very cool to see it blossom. And what the other thing that's been really cool is how, you know, growing up Asian American, I always felt like, oh, well, we're not American according to and we're not Asian according to the Asians, you're like, what are you? And so we are always in the middle, but what's been cool is also all the Asian entertainment that's come over here and how it's the rising tide has lifted all boats,
Yes, exactly.
So this collective idea and the idea that there was like the one has gone away, I feel like. You know, who's the one that's going to cut, who's the one star or the one show or the one movie that's going to break it open?
Right.
It's all of us working. And so that that feels like the kind of philosophy on the in the air, and I love it, you know?
Yeah.
And I'm making an effort too, like on a personal level. I'm like, I don't think I know enough Asian American writers, actors, directors. I'd like, and that I shouldn't wait for that to happen.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, like I gotta be active
in
doing that and making connections, and we'll see what happens.
Exactly. Exactly.
Anyway. All right. Cool. Well, that feels like a good place to end. That's all the time we have, but it was really great chatting with you, man.
Yeah.
And thanks to the audience for your questions.
Oh, and guys, my remix drops 9 p.m. today on my YouTube channel. So make sure you guys go to my YouTube channel, 9 p.m. Check it out.
Netflix is premiering Cowboy Bebop on November 19th.